Coming up before the end of the show, we'll be, of course, splashing trash with Nick Bassine over in Sydney. Right now, though.
My brother left no true-born heirs. By right and birth and blood, I do this day lay claim to the Iron Throne of Westeros. Let all true men declare their loyalty. The Iron Throne is mine by right. They will bend the knee or I will destroy them. The cold winds are rising.
Yes, it's not winter is coming, but the cold winds are rising. That is the trailer to Game of Thrones Season 2, a wee teaser. We're going to be talking about that very shortly with Chris Philpott over at stuff.co.nz, joining us now to talk On The Box stuff, and very bravely talking to us this morning after a drive back to Whangarei after the Foo Fighters concert last night. Man, what a mission. How are you?
Yeah, it was a long drive, all right. It was, say, 3:45 by the time I got into bed last night, and now we're up doing this. Radio, it's awesome.
Well, thanks.
If I sound incoherent, that's what it is.
It's all right.
It's just that.
Thanks for making it along. First up, the first story involves New Zealand's Next Top Model and their claims of no rigging after some controversy on the American version, Chris.
Yeah, it's an interesting story. I think for anyone who is skeptical of reality TV, this is almost vindication for those people. Janice Dickinson, who some viewers will know as one of the judges on America's Next Top Model, has become a kind of a whistleblower for that show, claiming that the judging is all handled off camera. They're basically just little avatars in the front of the camera for people to look at, but the real decisions are being made by CoverGirl Cosmetics, who provide the major prize for America's Next Top Model. They provide the winner gets to do a contract with them, go in their magazine, and gets a modeling agency contract as well. And Janice Dickinson is saying that they make the decision on who wins, not the judges on the show, as is shown to be the case on the show. It's hypocritical, where they're saying one thing but actually something else is happening. And what's happened is, in the wake of that, New Zealand's Next Top Model has come out and said that there is no rigging on their show, that the judges make all of the decisions. The three judges, of course, on New Zealand's Next Top Model, Sarah Tetreault, Colin Mathura Jeffrey, and Chris Sisarich, and they've invited Janice Dickinson down. But it just seemed like an interesting story, because there really is a conflict of interest on New Zealand's Next Top Model, I think, because Sarah Tetreault operates as the major judge on the show, but also the winner of New Zealand's Next Top Model gets a contract with her agency. So I can't see how that isn't a conflict of interest in some way, where she has a vested interest in making sure that the winner is someone who can be represented by her company. Obviously, that's the aim of the competition anyway. I'm not sure if it's a major conflict of interest, but
it's
there.
Should the public care, though? I mean, at the end of the day, it's reality TV. So, you know, it's entertainment. Whoever wins, win doesn't really matter. It's all the process of the infighting and the photo shoots themselves. I mean, it's all theatre, so does it really matter whether or not it's, you know, the hardcore judge's decision is final sort of business?
I think it is. If a producer is claiming that there are three judges sitting there and they're making the decisions, as in the case of America's Next Top Model, and they're actually not making decisions, then I think that's a huge problem for the producers. I think it's unfair. It's really misrepresenting themselves and lying to the public. In the case of New Zealand's Next Top Model, I don't think it's a big issue, because at the end of the day, the winner is someone who should be able to be represented by a modeling agency. But to kind of say, well, we're picking whoever does the best in the show, I think is unfair. They're picking who is going to be the best person with that contract, who they think will have the best future, and that's not explicitly stated.
And don't we suspect that some of that sort of stuff goes on anyway, particularly depending on where they are in the season? And if there is a character who does a bad photo shoot, but they're controversial in the house, you know, they're more likely to stick around. So we always kind of suspect that this trading off between entertainment versus who should actually win goes on.
Yeah, I think that definitely is the case, and it definitely seemed to be the case this year in New Zealand's Next Top Model, at least, where there were people getting kicked out despite good performances early on, and people staying on despite ongoing bad performances. Yeah. And I think that's where they kind of have an idea early on who is going to be the top three or four. And then from that point, it's the job of the producers to make sure there's an interesting narrative kind of flowing through the show. It's, you know, we say reality, but in fact, producers want a storyline. They want, you know, conflict in the house. They'll keep in characters that cause conflict and drama in the house that will be interesting for viewers.
Yeah. All right. As we mentioned at the top of the show, the new Game of Thrones Season 2 trailer has hit the internet, and already it's got everyone aflutter and talking and reviewing the trailer.
Yeah, there's Westeros.org is a fan website of Game of Thrones, not just the show, but the books and everything. It's a very expensive website, and people have spent a lot of time on it. And they've really done a really good breakdown of the trailer that is available on YouTube. It's titled Cold Winds, but the subtitle is The Cold Winds Are Rising, which is in reference to the second book of the Game of Thrones series, or A Song of Ice and Fire, I should say, is the name of the series. The second book is A Clash of Kings. The trailer itself is narrated by the character Stannis Baratheon, and what he's talking about is he's the next in line to the throne. We saw in last week's episode on Soho, and anyone who's seen the series will know that Robert Baratheon, the king, has passed on, and Stannis Baratheon's the next heir to the throne. And it's really interesting. The Clash of Kings sounds like a really interesting story. I'm trying not to give too much away, but it centers around a battle between five kings, basically Stannis Baratheon, Renly Baratheon, Joffrey Baratheon. I'm trying to remember them all now.
You're doing well.
The Greyjoy guy and Robb Stark is the other one.
Nice.
Who up in Winterfell. And it sounds like a really interesting story and should be the basis of a fantastic show, and plenty more surprise deaths, shall we say.
Definitely looking forward to April 2012 for Season 3 of Game of Thrones. Right, onto the review section, Underbelly, Razor and Dexter. You've combined these two.
I have combined the two because they both share an interesting thread. I've written today on the blog, actually, about Dexter. My concern is that it's going on for too long, and I'm not too sure if you're a fan of either of these shows, both, neither of them, I'm not too sure. But yeah. I really like Dexter. I wasn't big on Underbelly Razor, which finished last week on TV3. It just seemed a bit derivative. They're now, I think, Underbelly's kind of clawing at ideas for shows now, and this one seemed a little bit too derivative of something like Boardwalk Empire or Gangs of New York, the movie, where they're just trying too hard to come up with something interesting that they can do on TV. And the production level was high, but I think the story wasn't that great. And it was, they got rid of one of the really interesting characters only a few episodes in. But my concern with Underbelly is that they've got this style now where the narrator kind of tells the story and, you know, characters show up and their names flash up on the screen and they kind of jump from event to event without really tying them together too well. And I wonder if it's come to the end of its rope. A little bit.
As we've mentioned before about Dexter, I haven't seen any of it yet, but I'm probably going to tackle it over the summer because I'm looking for a new series, long form series that I can get into. So I'll be interested to see how it peters out. Like you say, it's just getting a little bit tired, a bit worn around the edges.
Well, it is Dexter. I mean, Underbelly Razor is more stylistic, is what has gotten old on it. I think the story is different every season, so it doesn't have that same formulaic sense about it. The style is what carries on, and I think we've had enough of that. Dexter, on the other hand, is quite formulaic, where it's the same kind of story every episode, and every season is the same kind of story as well. And it just got renewed for two more seasons. It's 7th and 8th. I think Underbelly Razor was like the 7th or 8th Underbelly season. And I just wonder how long these shows can go without turning away fans who are, you know, someone like me who's been watching Dexter from the start. My concern is 7 or 8 seasons later and it's declining in quality. I don't think it's been as good as it was the first couple of seasons. It's still been very, very good, but I don't think it's reached that peak. And with two more seasons, I'm thinking, well, what's the point? Is it going to keep declining?
Yeah.
At the end of the 8th season, are they just going to renew it for two more? And it's this, it kind of comes back, I guess, to the same old question of how long is too long for a show. You know, I always use the example of Lost, which set an end date and worked to it, whether that show was a success or not aside. They did set an end date and tried to work to that. And a show like Dexter just carrying on and on, you wonder if maybe they need to think about doing the same.
Yeah, you really want the Sopranos effect. You want all the people watching just going, oh, I can't believe this is finished. I don't want it to finish. You know, you really want to be on that high, I suppose. Hey, do you know when the finale for the second season of Boardwalk Empire is going to be on Soho? Or even they even said they started the second season?
They have started. We're only about 2 weeks behind the States.
Okay. Because I really want to talk about that.
I know why you want to talk about it too. That sounds like a very interesting show, but I think we might have to leave that one till January, mate.
Yeah, we might have to. But if you haven't got onto Boardwalk Empire yet and you've got access to Soho or other means to getting it, then do get into it. Right, okay, what is coming up on New Zealand TV this week?
Well, Thursday we've got the finale of 24 Hours in A&E on TV1, 8:30. Now, this is one of the underrated. It's really slipped under the radar, I think, for a lot of people. Still had high viewer numbers just because TV1 always does, but it's definitely a show that's worth checking out. The finale of that's on Thursday night. Basically, they just follow an accident in an emergency room in England with like a stack of cameras and just put everything that happens on screen. It's just riveting stuff. Next week, TV2's got Christmas programming for the kids. We don't often talk about kids programming on here because neither of us watch it, I suppose, but there's, you know, kids movies from 5 every day next week, and then Christmas specials from 7, things like the Toy Story Christmas special and things like that, I suppose. And then on Monday, the 2-hour season finale of The Mentalist. I don't know if you're a Mentalist fan. I quite enjoy it. I haven't enjoyed the third series as much, but I'm looking forward to the finale of the third series. That's Monday at 8:30.
I don't know. I haven't seen The Mentalist, but the fact that it's got the guy on that banking ad on it makes me want to watch it even less.
Well, that's a chicken egg scenario. He only got the banking ad because he was on The Mentalist.
Yeah, it's true.
Now the banking ad is putting people off The Mentalist. I tell you what, the annoying thing with that is the ad came on, I was fast-forwarding through the ads on The Mentalist, and that ad came on and I stopped the fast-forwarding. It took a couple of seconds before I went, oh crap, this is an ad, what am I doing?
That is smart programming.
That's the point of it.
The big question, we might be able to answer it next week, but will The Shawshank Redemption be screening on Christmas Day here in New Zealand? What do you think? What do you think? What are the chances?
We've got to keep up that 15-year streak. Yeah.
Chris Philpott is over at stuff.co.nz with the On The Box blog, and Chris Philpott NZ on Twitter. Thanks, mate.
Thanks, Weber.
New track from